Prince of Drusilla management. Several years now, years go by, did an experiment where we really wanted to see what Scylla's and HLB do to trees. I mean, HLB had been here for many years by then, and everybody would say, oh, just a single Scylla could kill a tree, and you know, and all these kinds of stories and tales get passed down, but nobody ever tests it. So we decided, well, yeah, well, really, what will happen to a tree if you just kind of let psyllids do whatever and let the pathogen that causes HLB do whatever? And can we control it? So we did an experiment like this to kind of prove to ourselves, you know, what actually happens. Does one psyllid really kill a tree? So we did these caged assays where we would cage psyllids on trees, both in the field and in the laboratory, at various frequencies of inoculation. Try to also see what management could do to kind of prevent the disease. So I'll show example trees of what happens after a year of this has been done. So the top tree was infested with psyllids just enough for a week with infested psyllids, and then they were killed off. And then those trees don't see any damage, any psyllids or anything ever again. The bottom trees were, for that year, just kept as the total control. It's HLB free. It was always free of psyllids. So the top tree after a year has HLB, and the bottom tree does not have HLB. And you could see through that top tree, you could see some symptoms of just the disease. It's not being infested. So it's lost some foliage. And that's kind of what a tree looks like after a year of having HLB. We were at that time kind of on a calendar-based application schedule where there were 12 sprays a year. So the top tree kind of shows what is in a program that is meant to mimic that. Those trees have had psyllids every month for a week on them that have HLB, and the bottom trees have had trees every month, or have had psyllids on them every month for a year that don't have the pathogen. So you can see that bottom tree looks kind of like the control way over on the left. It's pretty healthy. You know, just putting psyllids on those trees every month for a week really didn't do much to them. The top one, again, has the pathogen. You can see it's a little more yellow, and you can kind of see through it. It's lost some foliage. But if you manage psyllids every month for a year, you know, that tree still, it looks like many of the trees out there in the field today where HLB is being managed. And on the right is if you just do nothing, on top with HLB and on the bottom without HLB. And that tree, the one after a year, it's kind of, you know, it's hanging on with some leaves on it. But there's not much going, you know, it's looks poor. But you can see that the bottom tree that has had psyllids on it for a year, that without HLB, that one looks pretty ragged too. So really the combo of the two are what really does it. So of course, as a stopgap, we were spraying a lot. And this is, again, from about 2010 to 2018. It's just a typical spray program. You see, you know, you very well know it's expensive and eliminated populations of natural enemies. So what can we do, you know, to instead of this is what we'll talk about today. Now, this problem of insecticide use had other consequences. Of course, we started seeing resistance to neonicotinoids. And when you looked at those places where you don't rotate neonicotinoids, here's an experiment where we went back to a place where we got neonicotinoid resistance at one point, and then it reversed. And then we just applied neonicotinoids in a non-rotated way. In after three consecutive sprays, and then looking at those psyllids, we found that those psyllids are 2,000-fold resistant to neonicotinoids compared to plots where the neonicotinoids were rotated. And if you look at the psyllid numbers in those plots in the non-rotated, you could see in the NR where the Sillard numbers just go way up in the non-rotated plot. So you can experimentally show that, you know, you could test them in the lab and find that they're resistant, but you can then show that they're harder to kill. And then when we go in with a recovery rotation plan afterwards, you know, we knock them right back down. And then there's about a 6-month recovery period when you rotate pesticides before they get back to their susceptible state. But where we rotate, you know, the it's not a problem as long as we rotate modes of action correctly. So where we've been going, or what we've been suggesting, is how can we reduce insecticide input and still maintain HLB and psyllid management somewhat under control, so you don't see that disaster tree that was on the right-hand side where there was no psyllid control. And one thing that really has been, this has been around for a long time, it just has to be implemented. Phil Stansley started doing this many years ago, and Jawad, and it really works quite well. You keep the psyllids underneath a threshold level. Now you might say, well, how can you apply a threshold for a disease pathogen vector? Well, really we're not trying to prevent the spread of disease. The disease is everywhere. We just have to live with it. And we have to keep psyllids below a level where they injure the tree so much that the tree can't defend itself. It can't manage the disease. These trees have quite a bit of defense and immune response to the disease and the psyllid. And if we can keep the tree healthy, we can keep it hanging on without having to spray a million times a year. So what's critical to do is to spray at the very beginning of the season in the wintertime, really right now, prior to bud break and before a new flush is present, to really affect that life cycle at its weakest point. Take out any adults. They're hard to find, they're hard to see, but they're there. But this is the weakest time in their life cycle. You knock them down before they start laying eggs on the flush. Once that flush starts to show up, the second potentially most important spray is done there. If you didn't knock them back sufficiently with that dormant season spray, spray them again when there's visible flush, if they're reappearing on that visible flush. And those are probably your two best made sprays. And then as the growing season starts, you got to monitor your psyllids. You got to go out there and see what's going on. And 0.2 psyllids per tap is a very conservative threshold. You might not need to be this conservative. We found that in some groves, particularly older, more mature groves where trees are doing better, you can get away with a higher threshold, even 1 psyllid per tap. But in younger trees, it's better to be more conservative. This is the result of doing 10 taps in an area in 10 different trees and calculating a mean. So you spread out and you try to tap sample 10 trees. I go out with the grower, we just bash a branch underneath a piece of paper and count the psyllids that are on there. And if you reach, well, first of all, those first two sprays should give you about 60 days of good control. And then you start counting psyllids. And if you're below the threshold, you could bump this up even to 1. If you're below your threshold that you set, you don't do anything. You don't spray just because it's the next month. You spray in response to your psyllid population increasing. So if you reach if that threshold is triggered, then you spray. So it's a reactive spray to a need, because this is telling you right now that this spray is going to make economic sense. You're going to get a return for your investment. Now that threshold might be triggered again 4 weeks later, and it's important to spray again 4 weeks. And it might turn out that you did your two sprays 4 weeks apart in July, and those are the only two sprays you needed. They might occur in October, and those other months you may have not sprayed. So, and your sprays might differ from year to year when, you know, when they were necessary. So again, you throw out the calendar and you spray when in times of need. Then the area under the threshold line is where biological control hopefully provides you some benefit. Assumptions here is that you're not stopping the spread of HLB, and you're assuming that keeping the ACP below this chosen threshold boosts your yield via improved tree health. And we've done this where we took replicated places and we treated them with a calendar schedule, or in this case, three different spray thresholds, 0.2 per tap, 0.5 per tap, and 1 per tap. And we found over the course of the season that we had really no measurable difference in psyllid counts over the course of the season. But one thing we found is where in some of the plots where we reduced sprays, we really got our spider populations back up. Remember those spiders you used to see in your groves compared to the calendar? And then when we looked at both the number of fruit per tree and the weight per tree, these trees were just getting into production, so these numbers are pretty low. We really had no negative impact on yield by you know, bringing back the sprays from going on a calendar to spraying when it was necessary. And then if you look at the management costs and yield losses in the associated profit that you get, obviously as you increase your threshold and reduce the number of sprays, your input costs go down, right? Because you're spraying less. It's less material, less input for driving the tractor. So what we found was, as we increased the threshold, of course, we got greater profit because your input costs went down. But there's really no difference between the management costs of the calendar-based spray and that threshold. But really the any kind of yield loss that you can occur is more made up for than made up for by the reduction in input costs. So a lot of research is taking place on new ways to manage the psyllid also. These ideas are how can we manipulate the vector populations and the tree. One of the things that people are doing is putting BT into citrus to try to kill psyllids. This is a protein that's produced by bacteria that kill psyllids. You might have heard of BT corn. We've actually made transgenic citrus that expresses these BT genes, and we found that ACP survival is reduced greatly on these trees. Now they're transgenic trees. We're also trying to, if you take psyllids off of these plants, you could see that their guts are damaged. On the left-hand side is a microscope of a normal gut, and this one's off of a BT plant. This gut has a bunch of holes in it. That's what the BT protein does. It only affects insects. It doesn't affect vertebrates, and it creates these holes in the gut and kills the psyllid. So the idea here is to maybe plant the transgenic plants around a grove to serve as a barrier. Another way to put this BT into citrus is with citrus tristeza virus, mild versions of this virus that don't kill the tree. And when we put the BT in with these viruses, we also find that we're able to kill off significant numbers of psyllids. Finally, we're trying to manipulate the vector to make it less good at transmitting bacteria. And one way this is being done is by manipulating the symbionts in the psyllid. The psyllids have these symbionts called Wolbachia, and those Wolbachia help the psyllid with digestion. They're symbionts. They live in the psyllid. And what we could do is we can actually take these Wolbachia out of the psyllid, genetically engineer them, and then put them back in the psyllid by injecting them back in there. And now these Wolbachia produce new proteins that modify the psyllid. So one of the things we can do is we can modify these Wolbachia to produce proteins that gunk up the psyllid gut and prevent the CLOS pathogen from moving to the gut so that the psyllid can no longer reinfect trees. So the CLOS protein has to bind that gut in order for it to move through the psyllid back into the salivary gland so it could be spit back into another tree. But with these modified Wolbachia that produce these proteins that gunk up the psyllid gut, we can greatly reduce the transmission of the psyllid. Now, these new tools are probably quite a ways off. When you use a new pesticide these days, that pesticide probably had, in some cases, 2 decades of research behind it, and before it's available in the field. So this stuff is probably a ways out, hopefully not 2 decades out, but nonetheless some years out. So to conclude here, a new alternative that's being explored for suppressing psyllids is with the use of BT pesticidal proteins. One approach is to actually make genetically engineered plants that produce this protein, and we envision using these as trap plants that are more attractive to psyllids than cultivated citrus. Another way is to put these proteins into citrus with citrus justaza virus that replicates in the psyllid phloem where the psyllid actually feeds. Another thing that's being done is gene silencing RNAs that I haven't had time to talk about, but these could be shut down genes in the psyllid that the psyllid needs for survival, and they also show promise as control tools. And another novel approach is to modify the symbionts like Wolbachia in the psyllid to prevent or affect transmission. And this process of paratransgenesis does not actually genetically engineer the psyllid, but those symbionts that are reintroduced in the psyllid. You might ask, well, what happens to those symbionts? Do you have to inject all the psyllids out there in the field? Well, the psyllids actually then transmit these symbionts between each other when they reproduce. How can we manage psyllids now? Well, psyllid density is related to tree stress. The more psyllids, higher damage, which compromises yield. So it's important to spray for psyllids at bud break, at the beginning of the first flush, kind of right now if you're experiencing bud break, and before there's feather flush on which adults can lay eggs. If the population is sufficiently low, it does not pay to take control measures. As that population rises, it reaches a point where it justifies taking a control measure. And between 0.2 and 1 psyllid per tap is an effective ballpark. All right, I think I've run out of time for questions, but I will be around the rest of the day.